Welcome dear students, today we are going to discuss about macronutrients, criteria of essentiality, their role, deficiency and toxicity. Green plants which are autotrophic require some inorganic mineral nutrients for their growth and development. As many as 92 elements or nutrients have been found, out of which 23 are essential nutrients. That is, without them, plants do not complete their life cycle. These nutrients are divided into two groups on the basis of their quantity required by the plants. First group is that of macronutrients or macro elements. These are required by plants in large quantities, and these include carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, calcium, sulfur and magnesium. They are also known as major elements. Next group is of micronutrients or microelements. These are required in small quantities and are also known as trace elements. These include iron, manganese, boron, zinc, copper, molybdenum, chlorine, nickel, cobalt, sodium, silicon, aluminium, selenium, and vanadium. Among these micronutrients, nickel, cobalt, sodium, silicon, aluminium, selenium, and vanadium have been established as essential elements for some but not for all higher plant species. Out of these 23 essential nutrients, carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen are derived from the atmosphere and soil water, and the rest are supplied either from soil minerals and soil organic matter or by organic or inorganic fertilizers. Now, the criteria of essentiality of nutrients. Arnon and Stout in 1939 laid down the following criteria for judging the essentiality of mineral nutrients to the plants. The first criteria is that the nutrient must be absolutely essential for the normal growth and development. Second criteria is that the requirement of the nutrient must be specific and not replaceable by another nutrient. That is, non-availability of the nutrient to the plant causes a deficiency symptom, and the supply of specific nutrient alone can correct it. The last criteria is that the nutrient must be directly involved in the nutrition of the plants. For example, constituent of an essential metabolite are required for the action of an enzyme system. In addition to the direct involvement in nutrition, nutrient must be a part of a structural molecule and takes part in the biochemical process. Now, dear students, let us discuss the role, deficiency and toxicity of macronutrients. Plants need the right combination of nutrients to live, grow and reproduce. Too little or too much of any one nutrient can cause problems. Nutrient deficiency symptoms in a plant are the expression of metabolite disorders resulting from the insufficient supply of an essential nutrient, and toxicity symptoms are the expressions resulting from excess supply of an essential nutrient. These disorders and toxicities are related to the roles played by essential nutrients in normal plant metabolism and function. Now let us discuss the roles, deficiency and toxicity symptoms of these macronutrients one by one. First, we will discuss about carbon, hydrogen and oxygen, as their deficiency and toxicity symptoms are similar. Carbon forms the backbone of many plant biomolecules, including starch and cellulose. Carbon is fixed through photosynthesis from the carbon dioxide in the air and is converted to carbohydrates that store energy in the plant. Hydrogen also is necessary for building sugars, hence is required for plant growth. It is obtained almost entirely from water. Hydrogen ions are necessary for a proton gradient to drive the electron transport chain in photosynthesis and respiration. Oxygen is necessary for cellular respiration in aerobic organisms. Cellular respiration is the process of generating energy-rich ATP via the consumption of sugars made in photosynthesis. As whole life on the planet Earth is dependent on plants for food, which is produced from these three elements. So their deficiency means not only the death of plants, but also of the whole life that exists on earth. Plants absorb these three nutrients according to their need. Hence, these show no toxicity symptoms. Now let us discuss about nitrogen. Nitrogen is the mineral nutrient that plants require in the greatest amounts. Most plants absorb nitrogen from the soil solution primarily as inorganic nitrate ion and in few cases as ammonium ion. Nitrogen serves as a constituent of many plant cell components, including amino acids and nucleic acids, that is RNA and DNA. It is also found in porphyrins, certain hormones like indole acetic acid and cytokinins, and coenzymes. It plays an important role in photosynthesis, protein synthesis, respiration, growth, and in almost all metabolic reactions. Nitrogen deficiency rapidly inhibits plant growth. If such a deficiency persists, most species show chlorosis, that is, yellowing of leaves, especially in the older leaves near the base of the plant. Under severe nitrogen deficiency, these leaves become completely yellow and fall off the plant. When nitrogen deficiency develops slowly, plants often have woody stems. This woodiness is due to buildup of excess carbohydrates that cannot be used in the synthesis of amino acids and other nitrogen compounds. Such carbohydrates may also be used in anthocyanin synthesis, leading to accumulation of this pigment. This condition is revealed as purple coloration in leaves, petioles, and stems of some nitrogen deficient plants, such as tomato and certain varieties of corn. Plants with excess nitrogen supply are stunted, deep green in color, and secondary shoot development is poor. High nitrogen causes vegetative bud formation instead of reproductive bud formation. When excess nitrogen is in the form of ammonium ion, roots turn brown and appear unhealthy with necrotic root tips. Decreased plant growth, necrotic lesions on stems and leaves, vascular browning in stems and roots, severe chlorosis and stunting of new leaves are symptoms on some plants. Now, the role of phosphorus. Phosphorus is available in the soil solution primarily as phosphoric acid. It is an integral component of important compounds of plant cells, including the sugar phosphate intermediates of respiration and photosynthesis, and the phospholipids that make up plant membranes. It is also a compound of nucleotides used in plant energy metabolism, such as ATP, and in DNA and RNA. The characteristic symptoms of phosphorus deficiency include stunted growth in young plants and a dark green coloration of the leaves, which may be malformed and contain small spots of dead tissue called necrotic spots. Additional symptoms of phosphorus deficiency include the production of slender but not woody stems and the death of older leaves. Maturation of plant may also be delayed. In contrast to nitrogen, excess of phosphorus rarely has direct toxic effect under agricultural conditions because the phosphate ions are firmly sorbed and immobilized in the soil. However, it can induce deficiencies of micronutrients such as zinc or iron if accompanied by high pH values and iron oxide in the soil. Now let us discuss about potassium. Potassium, which is available as a monovalent cation K positive, plays an important role in regulation of osmotic potential of plant cells. It also activates many enzymes involved in photosynthesis and respiration. It is also involved in cell division, stromatal movement, and chlorophyll formation. The first observable symptom of potassium deficiency is mottled or marginal chlorosis, which then develops into necrosis primarily at leaf tips, at the margins and between veins. In many monocots, these necrotic lesions may initially form at the leaf tips and margins and then extend towards the base. As potassium can be mobilized to the younger leaves, These symptoms appear initially on the more mature leaves towards the base of the plant. The leaves may also curl and crinkle. The stem of potassium deficient plants become slender and weak with abnormally short internodal regions. In potassium deficient corn, the roots have increased susceptibility to root rotting fungi present in the soil, and this susceptibility together with effects on the stem results in an increased tendency for the plant to be easily bent to the ground, the condition that is termed as lodging. Except for soil damage, cases of potassium toxicity are rarely seen. However, some believe potassium excess can reduce the quality of fruit, causing, for instance, bitter pit in apples and induce calcium deficiency in various plants. In hydroponic lemon plant, potassium excess is thought to delay growth, scorching and scabbing of leaves and premature fall of leaves. In oranges, excess potassium is said to delay ripening, and in lupin, non-specific intercostal chlorosis has been observed. But this may also be a consequence of high chloride concentrations associated with heavy applications of potassium fertilizer. The another important macronutrient is calcium. Calcium is taken up by plants as the divalent cation Ca2 positive. It is used in the synthesis of new cell walls, particularly the middle lamella that separates newly divided cells. Calcium is also used in the mitotic spindle during cell division. It is required for the normal functioning of plant membranes and has been implicated as a second messenger for various plant responses to both environmental and hormonal signals. In its function as a second messenger, calcium may bind to calmodulin, a protein found in the cytosol of plant cells. The calmodulin-calcium complex regulates many metabolic processes. The characteristic symptoms of calcium deficiency include necrosis of young meristematic regions, such as the tips of roots or young leaves, where cell division and wall formation are most rapid. Necrosis in slowly growing plants may be preceded by a general chlorosis and downward hooking of the young leaves. Young leaves also appear deformed. The root system of calcium deficient plant may appear brownish, short, and highly branched. Severe stunting can occur if the meristematic regions of the plant die prematurely. The best known toxicity symptom of calcium excess is the lime chlorosis, caused by a shortage of activated iron ions resulting from high levels of lime in the soil. This type of chlorosis is observed most commonly in various kinds of fruits, decorative plants, and lupins. Magnesium uptake is usually initially encouraged by liming, but after a while, the disproportion between the calcium and magnesium ion concentrations has a negative effect, and signs of magnesium deficiency may therefore occur. Now let us discuss about sulfur. Sulfur is taken up by the plant in the form of divalent sulfate anion. It is found in two amino acids, namely cysteine and methionine, and is a constituent of vitamins like biotin and thiamine, and coenzyme A, an important component in respiration and fatty acid metabolism. In the form of iron sulfur proteins, it is important in electron transport reactions of photosynthesis and nitrogen fixation. It is also essential for chlorophyll formation, cell division, and fruit formation. The sulfur-containing thiocyanates and isothiocyanates are responsible for pungent flavors of mustards, cabbages, turnips, horseradish, and other plants of family Brassicaceae. Many of the symptoms of sulfur deficiency are similar to those of nitrogen deficiency, including chlorosis, stunting of growth, and anthocyanin accumulation. This similarity is because both nitrogen and sulfur are constituents of proteins. However, chlorosis caused by sulfur deficiency generally occur initially in mature and young leaves, rather than in the old leaves as in nitrogen deficiency. because unlike nitrogen, sulfur is not easily remobilized to the younger leaves in most species. Sulfur deficiency also impairs protein synthesis, because of which the ability to form stable chlorophyll protein complexes is also impaired. Reports of sulfate toxicity are rare. The symptoms have been seen only in case of citrus, which at a total sulfur content of 0.5% shows small leaves which turn yellow at the margins. The discoloration then spreads to intercostal areas and unites until the whole leaf turns yellow. Next important macronutrient is magnesium. Like calcium, magnesium is also taken up as the divalent cation Mg2 positive. Magnesium is generally less abundant in soils than calcium, but is required by plants in relatively large amounts. In plants, magnesium has a specific role in the activation of enzymes involved in respiration, photosynthesis, and the synthesis of DNA and RNA. Magnesium is also a part of ring structure of the chlorophyll molecule and is also required to stabilize ribosome structure. It is critical to reactions involving ATP, while it serves to link the ATP molecule to the active site of the enzyme. The first and most pronounced symptom of magnesium deficiency is chlorosis, due to the breakdown of chlorophyll in the regions of the leaf that lie between the veins, that means the intervenous regions. If the deficiency is extensive, the leaves may become yellow or white. An additional symptom of magnesium deficiency is premature leaf abscission. High concentration of magnesium ions in the soil and plants can cause damage by disturbing calcium-magnesium balance. The damage particularly affects the roots, which are very sensitive to calcium deficiency, but symptoms similar to calcium deficiency can also appear on above ground parts as seen in case of sugar beet. With this, we come to the end of the topic in which we discussed the role, deficiency and toxicity symptoms of macronutrients. Hope you have understood it well. See you next time with another topic. Till then, goodbye.